I'm Brent Johnson, and today we're on the campus of Girard College in Philadelphia, and we are in the chapel, and with me is Dylan David Shaw. Dylan, what do you do here in Philadelphia?
I am an assistant organist at the Wanamaker Organ in Macy's in downtown Center City, Philadelphia.
Oh, wow.
I'm also on the restoration team of the Wanamaker Organ, so I'm there pretty much all week, helping with the ongoing restoration of the organ and playing four of the daily concerts every week.
Oh, wow. Well, and then as you were learning to play the organ, you were exposed to this wonderful instrument here. How did you get to know this organ?
When I was in high school, I used to frequent the store a lot, mm-hmm. and I met Michael Stairs there, who was the former organist of the Philadelphia Orchestra. I started having lessons with him shortly after, and this was one of the frequent organs that I had lessons on through my high school years.
Okay. So this is an E.M. Skinner organ from 1931. It was, as I understand, the last Ernest M. Skinner organ that he had a hand in.
One of the last.
One of the last. So, yeah.
872.
Certainly one of the biggest at the end there. How many ranks do we have, do you know?
103, I believe.
103. So this is a big instrument. This is going to take a little time to go through. Dylan is up on the platform. I'm down here behind, which is why this looks so strange. But I'm going to let him just take us through this organ and through the divisions, and we will hear some of the wonderful sounds of this amazing instrument. I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you.
So this is Chuck Gibson. He is an organ technician here in Philadelphia, and you know this instrument very well here at Girard College. You were a student, correct?
Yes.
That's where you first fell in love with the organ?
Yes.
Tell me, how was that growing up and listening to this instrument?
I was admitted as a student here in September of 1962,
okay,
and first heard this organ, and I thought, I need to learn more about this organ. So over the years, I took piano lessons, and then with the music director at the time, whose name was Anthony Filatico. And the next year, he was going to start me on the organ. And unfortunately, he was no longer here the next year, so I had to wait a few more years, and had one single organ lesson on this instrument from Carlo Curley.
Oh, wow.
And that just inspired me to learn more about how the organ worked, show me the pipes, let's see every part of it. And then at the time, there was a project taking place with the organ, and every day the technicians were here. As soon as school let out at 4 o'clock, I was right behind them asking a million questions. And finally they said to me, why don't you just come work for us when you graduate? So I did.
Oh, wow. Well, besides E.M. Skinner's unique tonal palette, this is a really unique organ in itself. I mean, first of all, how tall is this room?
It's just about 100 feet from the floor, from the lowest point on the floor to the organ chamber.
And all of the organ chamber are completely in the ceiling.
100,
so 100 feet away. And then there's nothing soft that I can see. The sound reverberates in here very well.
On the balcony back there, there is acoustic tile in the corners.
Okay.
That was put in early in when the chapel was fairly new, because the acoustics were too live.
Oh, too live. Well, it makes the organ sound great, and I can't wait to go up and see what that gigantic chamber looks like.
Sure.
So a tour of the chamber starts with a very long walk from the front of the chapel all the way to the rear, and then up a lot of stairs. We'll speed through as much of this process as we can, but just to give you an idea, it is a lot of stairs. We reach a locked gate, and then more stairs. Eventually, we get to the level of the ceiling of the chapel. But that's not it yet. We still have more stairs to get up to the organ chamber level. We continue to walk higher and higher. And finally, we're at the level of the organ chambers. We're going to start by going to the echo division first. It's located here by itself in the back. This little room just contains the 6 ranks of pipes for the division.
This speaks into a tone chute that goes down to the grill.
We go back out to go towards the main part of the organ. We can see the wind line for the echo division there running through the attic. Most of the organ is located up here, and we're going to start by entering the swell chamber.
Now, we were told when I was a student here, although I've never seen this document in writing, that when the organ was installed, that they actually lifted it by crane and in through the roof before the roof was put on the building.
So we can see this is a very tall chamber. The swell is double stacked. It's not very deep, though. To get through, we have to squeeze back behind these pedal pipes. So we'll let the squeezing begin. Halfway through, we can see some of the stop controls there, as well as get a peek into the pipes that are right up against the shades. Now we're on the other side of the chest, looking back in. There is no room in the front. Pipes peek right into the shades. Look underneath. And now we're going to go out into the grate area.
So this is the 32-foot... this is the 32-foot's over there.
Oh, yeah.
This is the 16-foot
That's
open.
The V-line.
I thought this was the 16-foot open. I thought that was...
No, 16-foot open's behind you.
Okay.
Just a little more history on the building. The original chapel that was here, if I remember... my notes right, was built in 1881, and by the late 20s, they determined that the chapel couldn't easily support the size of the student body anymore. The original organ in the first chapel was a Jardine, and it was replaced in about 1920 by an Austin. That Austin organ was sold to the Spring Garden Street United Methodist Church, and as far as I know, it's still there.
And we are standing over that giant grid in the ceiling of the church.
All right, so that's the 8 foot tall tube, but it used to be over there.
Right over in that space where those two pieces of 2x10 are laying across the beams.
And when did it get moved to where it is now?
It was first turned upside down in its original space in 1973. And the way the pipes were hung, they started to self-destruct. So I helped Bruce Schultz take them out, and we took them to Trivo Corporation in Hagerstown, Maryland, had them all repaired. And at his request, I installed it back here with lots and lots of support on those pipes.
But we think they maybe wanted to put them in the solo originally?
That was an interesting point that Dylan brought up, that was there room in the solo? Yes, I think there's physical space in the solo, but they were never in there to my knowledge.
And so this is the grate out here.
End pedal.
Grate and pedal.
Bombard.
The pedals over here, some of the grate over here.
Pedal mixture.
Now the grate, double-decked pedal in front of it, and the 32-foot bombard behind both.
Okay, let's go look at that.
Yep.
The skinny thing, 32 foot open.
So now we're walking towards the opposite end of the chamber, and we have to squeeze again between these 32 foot reeds and the beams of the ceiling here.
Here is the trombone here, which then extends into the 32-foot bombard.
Yes.
Legato 32.
Are the relays getting replaced as part of the restoration, or?
I don't recall that, the specifics of that. The proposed console will be a replica of the original with all solid state internals.
Now we are up on the grate, the upper level. Getting up here requires climbing a tall ladder. But from up here, you can get a good view of the entire chamber area.
See that four rank mixture there?
Mm-hmm.
That's the Harmonix. That was the one that was replaced in 1973 with a 1 foot pitch mixture and subsequently replaced again with something closer to the original.
Down on the floor, we go through a door right behind the grate, and we are now in the choir division. This is just exactly opposite the chevron-shaped opening from the swell. Get a bumpy look around in there. This is up on the wind chest. Again, very tall chamber with two levels. The harp is up above us. And then out through the door that takes us back out where we were in the attic. And we're not done yet.
So one of the things we were told about this building as students here, this building was built with the intention of being bomb-proof. I don't know what kind of bombs they talked about. Let's go down to the next floor. Here you go. Here's the original Woods blower motor. When it had to be replaced, they elected just to abandon it outside the chamber.
You want to carry it downstairs?
Somebody wants to carry it downstairs.
And there is the new blower motor. One of the things that's really interesting about this blower configuration and is the number of pipes that come off of the regulators going out to the various parts of the organ. And then this door is just right next to the blower room.
Solar division.
Here's a look at the pipes of the solo division, which is a large division. There's the Corno di Bassetto there. The 16 foot is against the back wall. And we noted that here on this side, there is definitely a space where a tuba could have gone, had this been the original intention to put the tuba inside the solo division under expression. But it was never put in here. Instead, it has always lived out in the area under the grate.
So Dylan and Chuck, thank you so much for showing us around this wonderful 100 plus rank E.M. Skinner organ from 1931. This is an amazing room. You have to come see it. I don't think our microphones are capable of delivering exactly what it's like to hear this room with no soft surfaces and a huge 100 foot ceiling with the organ above you. So if you ever get a chance to come to Philadelphia and visit Girard College, please do. I'm glad to hear that restoration efforts are underway and wonderful that we have great talent that can show off this wonderful instrument. So thank you for watching. If you've enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and remember to subscribe. We have more videos from Philadelphia coming up. And until then, you can always get streaming classical organ music on our three stations, OrganLive.com, Positively Baroque, and The Organ Experience. I'm Brent Johnson. Thanks for watching.